Again, thank you everyone for being here. What I plan to do is talk about some concepts and ideas and kind of some specifics. Not a ton of specifics because we only have an hour. I also want to introduce Evan Marks and Don Burns that are in the group somewhere. They're both Rethink coaches. And if you join our in-depth online workshop, they will be leading the discussion groups. So forgive me for making you look at my name. We're actually trying to trademark the Scholl method and our lawyer keeps saying, oh, you have to use it in slides. So I don't know, we're using it as slide. Seems silly to me, but in any event, let's get started with the real stuff. So, everyone's taught like have the plan, trade the plan, focus on improving the plan. But the reality of the situation is your P&L comes out of like your market, the market, however the market's behaving, your method, which is your plan, and your ability to execute. And as everyone knows, it's the ability to execute that's a little bit of a challenge. That's a function of your mental, or what I like to call your psychological capital. Like, what is your mental, psychological, other people would say emotional state? Well, that's a thing, actually, that can be analyzed, managed, and leveraged through what I call your personal mental matrix. And we'll talk about what that is. So I started the Sun Valley workshop, and I will start this mini workshop today and probably all workshops with this quote, because I really think this is the gig. Noticing. By the way, can everyone mute themselves because I'm getting actual feedback? The range of what we think and do is limited by what we fail to notice. Just think about that. The range of what we think and do is limited by what we fail to notice. And because we fail to notice that we fail to notice, there's little we can do until we do notice how failing to notice shapes our thoughts and deeds. When it's all said and done, everything I've ever done in trading psychology and everything the Rethink group does now is really about helping people notice so that they get a wider choices, wider range of choices, wider possibility of behavior through awareness, really. So let's talk about some standard bad advice. Common mistakes. There's research in the hedge fund world that shows the most common mistakes among professional money managers, the people that get paid the big bucks, is round tripping, meaning they let it go to whatever their intended price target is and they let it come back. Now, I know a lot of you are, independent traders, and probably we've all done this. I think it's in a way somewhat common or comforting, but also somewhat shocking to find out it's the most common mistake among the professionals. But according to Essentia, which did in-depth research on this, it is. Another really common one is getting stubborn, trying to force things. And another really common one is hesitating and taking the less optimal trade after you miss the better one. Anyone want to add a mistake to this list? And feel free to unmute yourself and speak up for a moment. Don't everybody talk at once. Okay. So what's the conventional wisdom? Like, use your cognition, be objective, be probabilistic, be rational, and be unemotional. If that advice was good, most of you wouldn't be here. And certainly among the professional money manager crowd, you wouldn't have round tripping as the most common mistake. So there's these outdated ideas you hear all the time. The really common one is system one and system two. Now, it's really unclear if Daniel Kahneman meant it as a metaphor or if he literally meant it, but most people think he literally meant it. And, you know, I can see this every day on Twitter. Like, you know, I'm using my system one. I don't really remember which one is which right now. I think system one is the one you're not supposed to be using. This idea, you know, forgive me for contradicting a Nobel Prize winner, but it's kind of outdated if you look at the brain research. Limbic system, you'll still hear that. You'll still hear amygdala hijack. It's not, it doesn't really happen. It seems like it happens, just like system one and system two seem like they happen. It's not really what's happening. Old brain, new brain, you know, you have this innately superior frontal cortex. Yeah, it can do a lot of cool things, but is it innately superior? You know, the capacities of the frontal cortex are a little bit like quantitative trading, and without, you know, some confidence factor baked in, you can't really trade just with an algorithm, and algorithms have confidence factors baked in. We can get into that discussion, but you don't really have an old brain, new brain. I know it makes everybody feel good because it's like you're not, if you have two systems or you have an amygdala hijack or you have an old brain and new brain, like it feels good because the mistake's not your fault. But I don't know, like, would you rather learn how to make fewer of those mistakes and feel good about your performance and yourself because you learned how to make fewer of those mistakes, or just say, oh, well, I make these mistakes because I have a system one and a system two or a limbic system or an old brain. Like, I don't know, I'd rather, you know, survive and come out the other end and do well despite these supposed things that your brain has or does. The idea of lie to me, which is that there are five basic emotions, Paul Ekman, you will still see this. The research says it's kind of not true. And a fabulous article, it's called Zombie Ideas by Lisa Feldman Barrett in Psychological Science. She wrote it two or three Halloweens ago, but you can Google it. And it gives you, like, you know, a 900 word version of these ideas are outdated. So I don't know about you, but I like the new ideas. I'd like to work with the latest of what we know. And I think it's the most powerful if we work with ourselves the way we're really built. So the game changer is really this. And if you'll notice, this comes from 2005. So literally the very first year I started speaking about trading psychology. I wrote my first article in 2004, but the first time I spoke out loud about it was 2005. I went and I found this summary, it's called a meta-analysis article by the neuroeconomist about decision-making. And this, you know, jumped out at me, and anyone who was around back then, you know how often I used to quote this. It's not enough to know what should be done, one must also feel it. Like, that's the problem. And that's the dimension you've got to work with if you want to get to where you want to get, if you want to get to the next level, if you want to break through the either repetitive mistakes or the mental blocks, you've got to work with what you're feeling. And it's not just me saying it. So here's some other scientists. Part of the reason we're here is the number of research papers doubled back when I was first starting talking about this, and then they doubled again. Now, I don't know what the updated statistics are for a decade later, but I'm sure they've doubled yet again. So the point being, you know, I was a trader starting in 94. I started running a desk in 97. Like, I read all the trading psychology, but there wasn't much research about emotion. So people who were writing about it, like Mark Douglas, poured his heart and soul into those books, but he didn't have thousands of papers on how emotion really works to integrate into his advice. Now we've got it. Emotion determines how we perceive our world, organize our memory, and make important decisions. I just go, well, okay, if something determines something else and the something else matters to me, I want to know what it is. I want to know as much about it as I possibly can. So here's some research done a while ago, that individuals who experienced the most intense feelings or more intense feelings achieved higher decision-making performance. This was in investing. It doesn't say that on this slide, but this was a study specifically about investing in the stock market. So like this, I don't know. It seems like it's something we've got to pay attention to. So here's the like central, most important tenet, most important idea, that if you ultimately learn how to work with this and how to integrate it into your trading, it absolutely will change your results in a positive way. Anticipatory affect. It means you are anticipating a feeling. So it's this subconscious prediction of like how anything's going to make you feel. If you stop for a second, like right now, and listen to yourself, you can probably detect like your expectation about how this webinar is going to make you feel, how these words are going to make you feel. You signed up basically because you thought it would make you feel good, because you thought you would learn something or find out about something, then that would be satisfying. You can ask yourself that question any moment of the day in anything that you're perceiving and judging, you know, even what you want for dinner. Like, what do I think I'm going to feel in the future? And you will find, if you do this, that there's always a feeling you're predicting, because this is the way the brain really works. It ends up being the answer to things like confirmation bias, recency bias a little bit. But when we go through the 12 weeks, what we will do is take this real reality of the human brain and turn it into practical strategies and tactics that you can use as you face trading decisions, whether it's entering or exiting, as you face any decision, but obviously we're focused on trading. So during the pandemic, I was reading Brian's latest paper on anticipatory affect, which he's put together like all levels of the brain, from your brainstem to brain chemistry, through the amygdala to your frontal cortex, and how it works at every level of the brain. And I knew that he considers it the sun rises in the east of perception, but I thought, well, let me just ask him. And so I asked him on Twitter, like, Brian, how pervasive is this anticipatory affect? And that was his answer. If you don't have it, you die. So if you're not predicting a future feeling, you're like not living. It's imperative, which makes it an opportunity. That's the biggest thing. Like, this realization about how our brains actually work makes this an opportunity. So to change gears a little bit, talk about a feeling, a specific feeling, which is desire. You know, there can be a lot of talk about don't have any desires. It's not all that realistic. If people are truthful, we have desires, and in their pure form, like all emotions, they're meant to help us. So most of us have a desire for certainty, and the market, of course, doesn't give us any certainty. We want it. We want to feel like it's certain. We want to feel like we know. But what is it in reality? It's extraordinarily ambiguous. Like, you know, any sort of signal could mean buy or sell most of the time. You could make an argument either way. And literally no one knows what's going to happen. No one knows what's going to happen to Bitcoin tonight. No one knows what the equity indices are going to do tomorrow.
Hello, please leave a message after the tone.
Can everyone mute themselves, please? Know who's calling who, but you probably don't want us to hear your message. Anyway, what happens when we encounter uncertainty, or when we're conscious of it, is we want to create certainty. Because if we have some certainty, it creates an expectation of feeling safe, creates an expectation of low risk. In other words, you have this anticipation, I feel like I'm saying that wrong, of feeling okay, things being fine, no threat. Well, so you try to create certainty in trades. And one thing that creates certainty is doing something. Like, if you take an action for a moment, a minute, some period of time, you feel better because you took the action because it seems more certain. Usually when you take those actions, trying to create certainty, they're the kinds of ones that make you say, why did I do that? Simon, I see you say I can mute all participants, but me finding the button to do that is going to be a little tricky. So as long as everyone mutes themselves and we don't hear much more, I'll cross my fingers. So here's something we do in the workshop. We turn these things into tactics that you can use. So in the case of uncertainty, like put yourself through an exercise where you really grapple with the fact that you can't know. You're going to find that you don't like it and it's uncomfortable. And you know it intellectually. Intellectually, you know. Emotionally, you don't like it. Because emotionally, it does make you feel unsafe. So people have heard me talk about this before where we've done a creative exercise. And if you join for the 12 weeks, we will do that. A creative exercise around this grappling. But I wanted you to see how we come with ideas for each, you know, concept, or we try to. So desires to make money. Everything about trading has a social context, meaning other people. So the market strategy piece is social, right? Like at the end of the day, prices only are prices because other people are buying or selling. There's no, you know, God of the market out there somewhere that's not a human being. Granted, some people express their buying and selling desires through algorithms, but there are still people behind them, and those people make discretionary decisions in terms of implied volatility, and they make discretionary decisions about when to run the algorithm or when not to. So like the market is nothing other than a social perception game, and there's nothing that's like true value. It's just all relative to what it was before. So on the flip side, the risk management side, which comes from our self-image, is also social. Like we're all always sort of asking, where do we fit in the world? Where do we rank ourselves? Are we good enough? Will we be safe? So these desires, it integrated with the idea that there's a social context, they become specific avenues that you can go down in terms of understanding not only your market strategy, but your own self-image and how it's playing itself out in the market vis-a-vis this prediction of a feeling or vis-a-vis this anticipatory affect. And so when you start to understand how to deal with the question of, will you be safe in trading? Again, it expands your possibility of choices. And by expanding your possibility of choices, you have more ability to avoid the choices that don't make you money and more ability to capitalize on the choices that do make you money. So in all the workshops and in this one coming up, we'll do this where there will be samples, you know, this is a sample, where there will be discussion exercises around the idea, in this case, desire. Like this is a really super interesting one. How much do you really want trading success and what it would mean? Everyone thinks they want it, but there are implications to it for people. And it helps to, with all actually feelings, to know what they are, to externalize them, to make the unconscious conscious. So each week we'll have different discussion topics, and then you'll have your small group meetings with even Evan or John and Bill Long, my partner, who some of you know will join in on those. Well, you'll be able to go through discussion about specific questions to help you grapple with it, get other people's perspective, work it through for yourselves. There will also be homework each week that will be individual. And obviously I'm not gonna ask you to turn it in or grade it, or, you know, grade the class in a bell curve or anything, but there will be specific exercises that you can go through to get you to the point that I would like everyone to be by the end. So it really, you know, if you've listened to me for any period of time, you've heard me talk about intuition versus impulse. And it really is, as a couple of you, Edgar and Jim, sent me questions this morning, you know, it is knowing the difference, right? So Jennifer Lerner of Harvard calls the two types of feelings integral and incidental. I first call them information and irrelevant, but that's true. You have feelings that have information and you have feelings that are irrelevant. And the trick is to know the difference. In practicality to trading, it's intuition, which is unconscious pattern recognition, which is based on all the time you've spent staring at the screen, or impulse, which is some other thing, feeling, you know, that urges you to do something that's either creating certainty or avoiding some threat, avoiding some expectation of a future emotion. So the trick is to learn to sort these out. And in a way, all of our work at Rethink is really about this. So one thing you can realize is that every single trade or non-trade, like everything you do in the market that you don't want to do, is some unconscious feeling being acted out. Like literally, that's the problem. So we do the feeling instead of feeling the feeling, analyzing the feeling, understanding the feeling. But there are ways that you can mitigate this. There are ways that you can interrupt this. There are ways that you can reduce it. Will you never do it? Hey, somebody's speaking and not muted. I'm gonna mute the one person I see. I can't see everyone, is also part of my problem. You guys can still hear me, right? You can still hear me? Okay. Back to what I was saying. Like literally, this is the thing, is to figure out how to not do this. And once you get the brain right and this anticipatory affect right, and you start to get conscious of what you're predicting and where those predictions are coming from, so you can sort out the ones that are actually about the market from the ones that are just about your self-image or just about your future safety that, you know, are infused with your life, you have this whole other really more powerful level than system one, system two, amygdala hijack, you know, old brain, new brain. What's my slide doing? So a little bit of information about I just know, intuition. This is a brain study. Those who are more adept at exiting a move, meaning a trader that can get out, because this was about trading, before it reverses, experience a particular signal in a particular part of the brain. So Brian Newton and some of these other guys are particularly interested in trading, and they did this research that shows, you know, if you're really good at getting out, almost at the, you know, extent of the move, they could see it in your brain. So like something's happening, right? Something's happening that you can learn to capitalize on. Some people call it visceral intelligence. You know, the more of an expert someone is, the more their expertise exists on a visceral level, a physical level. So we want to help you learn to access that, analyze it, so you know, is it information and integral to a trading decision, or is it, maybe it's information, but it's irrelevant to your trading decision. And the skill to sort through what is what is the skill you want. Like if you, the more you get at that skill, the more you'll be able to execute your trades like you want to. So back to the failing to notice and ability to execute, it's literally learning this dimension of information that, you know, no one taught you for no other reason because they didn't know. So exploring the nature of trading intuition. For anyone who has tried to play the brain game, this is what it's built on. Market participation engages theory of mind. Theory of mind means theory of your mind, like reading other people and not math. Theory of mind correlates with trading performance and math doesn't in this experiment. So this is what the intuition game is based on. I meant to log onto this and I didn't, and I'm not gonna do it now because it'll probably mess up this whole thing. But what I am gonna do is, can you all give me an idea of who's tried to play it? And I'm fine if you want to speak up. I did not meet everybody to my knowledge. Or if you just want to type in the chat. I wish I could see everybody. It only lets me see like a few people. Well, John, do I have to like give you permission?
I guess so.
There you are. I don't want to have to give you permission. So I don't know how this is working, but anyway, can you talk about the brain game for a second? Whatever you want to say, you have the floor.
Oh, great. I was just saying that I have played the game, brain game, but it's really cool. It's about creating a story in my mind. And the more I was able to create that story and react, the better off I did. When I thought about the answer, I was usually wrong.
I can't hear it.
That Denise? Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. I mean, we've had people who said, like, even we've had some good tutors say, oh my God, I can't do it. But generally speaking, what the research shows is the better you can do it, the better you trade. That doesn't mean everyone who can trade well can do it, but, you know, statistically speaking, the trick is to not think. The trick is just to not think at all. Like, watch the shapes move and pay attention to like literally whatever the first thing that comes to your mind is. And the point of it is to help you practice doing that, like to not think and to listen to your body. Because why? It's the physical signals where expertise and intuition exist. You know, why can anyone think about anything you know how to do? You know, a sport, math, anything you know how to do. Think about to when you very first did it. When you very first did it, you know, you had to like go, okay, like let's take golf, you know, I'm gonna pull this swing back, I'm gonna, like you have to think about each step. And then the better you get at it, the less you have to think about each step, because the knowledge goes from this linear cognitive step-by-step front brain thing to a feel. It goes from consciousness into your body. Arthur says in the chat, I played it several times. The more I tried to figure it out, the worse I did. Once I treated it as free association, I started to do better, because you just answered whatever, you started answering more of whatever your body was telling you. The point of us providing the game is to help people get experience with that, like in a obviously harmless, risk-free environment. So, yeah, John, it's definitely a part of music, right? At first you had to learn note by note by note, and then you start to learn how to like get. We'll open it up to questions. So trading is this social emotional probability game. It's disguised as a math problem, but it's not really. Like maybe probabilities can help, but they're not the actual answer. Like what's the difference between 40% probability and 20% probability? What does that really tell you in terms of trade? But the trick is, because this anticipatory affect, because we are predicting a future feeling related to whether we're safe, you know, surviving and thriving, and we're always doing it, we do it based on our past experience. So as we learn something, back to what we were talking about a moment ago, we start to both put the knowledge into our body, but we also start to what? We have confidence that we know how to do the thing, whatever it is. You know, me ski down those slopes out there, John Burns swing a golf club, you know, whatever your thing is, it goes from step by step by step and, you know, unsure whether you can do it to more sense that you can do it and more in your body. So then you predict you can do something out of that sense that you can, that's in your body, that sense of recognition. So the trick ultimately to really getting better is to create new past experiences in trading that you can draw on, so that you know, when you get into a trade and it doesn't work right away, instead of, you know, freaking out, to use a blunt term, and saying you've got to jump out, you have, you feel confident that you will be safe in the future if you let it play out as you planned. And then if you do that once, twice, three times, four times, five times, which it becomes easier to do if you're externalizing these future emotions you're predicting and you're navigating them in a different way, then you start to create these new past experiences to draw on, i.e. you literally build confidence. I mean, we talk all the time about building confidence, but no one talks about exactly how to do it. Like, or they tell you to do it through your head. You know, they, like, I see this all the time, be confident. I have a client, it's actually not in the trading industry, and they hired me to help one of their people be more confident because he's not executing as well as he could. And I've been working with the guy for like 6 weeks. And so I agreed to have a joint meeting with the guy that owns the company and this employee. And the guy who owns the company gets on and says, well, he just has to be more confident. And I'm like, you know, all of us would be more confident if we could just tell ourselves to be more confident, right? You guys are over here, so I'm looking over here. Like, it doesn't work that way. You have to go through the experiences that create the feeling that you can do something. Ed, so trading is a right brain activity. Well, in the way that people think about right brain, the truth is left brain, right brain is sort of outdated at this point also. Like, the truth of the matter is you're really using all of your brain all the time in everything to predict a future feeling. You predict future thoughts and events also, but the thing that, like, this is the other thing that people miss all the time. Like, you don't act on your analysis. You act on how you feel about your analysis. Like, you do the analysis, you do the work, and it makes you feel as if it's going to work. It's going to give you some level of confidence, some, you know, 60, 70% probability it's going to work. The dimension that matters is that feeling. So in that sense, Ed, you're saying right brain is more associated with feeling. So the idea of a right brain is yes, that's correct. Except that right brain and left brain isn't so much a thing anymore. So I think I've just got a couple more slides and then we'll open it up. We'll do just free form and Q&A. So if you think if you get disciplined about your psychological capital, about your mental state, like, play out the difference. Okay, you notice you're trading, you notice you're feeling frustrated. And you think, okay, I'm putting myself into a risky situation. So you walk away and avoid some impulsive trade. Like, let's just start with, you hesitated, didn't take the trade. You're annoyed, you wanna find the next trade. This happens all the time, by the way, in trending markets, where people miss the trend and then they just try to find the opposite trend just to grab some money because they're so frustrated. And of course it tends not to work. But in any event, so notice you're frustrated. It's, you know, say my psychological or mental capital is debited. I'm gonna walk away. I'm gonna avoid that impulsive or compulsive trade and I've saved those losses, right? So you come back an hour later or whatever, and you don't feel so bad because you didn't waste some stupid money that you're mad at yourself for. And because you feel better at that point in time, your mood, which is what the sum total of how you feel, it's easier to find and take that next right trade, which then what makes you feel better, that makes you able to take the next trade. As opposed to if you did the impulsive or compulsive trade, then you're mad at yourself, then you just want to get that money back, and then you take the next trade and, you know, spirals down we go. It says Goldman in light gray there, because I used to have this client who, by the way, traded for Goldman Sachs, only ever tried to break even, was absolutely committed to coming into the office every day and breaking even. This is a successful Goldman trader, because he said, if I only ever try to break even, I don't get involved in choppy markets, and it becomes really clear to me when the market's starting to trend, and I can kill it, like on the days when the market's really moving. And he'd been at Goldman for like a decade when I worked with him, and said he'd made most of his money in like 2 or 3 weeks over any given year. Why? Because he just wasn't getting into this, you know, impulsive compulsive trades. This is a clue. Like, everybody's just like, you know, play on the trade, trade the plan, be disciplined. People beat themselves up about discipline. The place you want to be disciplined is this mental psychological capital. And there's a whole world of things you can do to help yourself do that. And then you avoid the situation. And then you avoid that, you know, 25% of your worst trades. Like, look at this year and say, what if I avoided the bottom 20 to 25% of my trades? What would my P&L look like? Well, it's always radically different. How do you do that? You do it through managing to your psychological capital. So what we do in the workshop is build this matrix out. And this doesn't have all the detail, but we build a personal version, or we guide you, lead you to building out a personal version of this. So you start with like whatever your intuition is that comes from your analytical lens, whatever it is. You know, I don't care. Technical, fundamental, different kinds of technical, voodoo, astrology, I don't care, however you analyze the market, figure that out. And like, are you comfortable? What's your real confidence in it? And that feeds in to a spectrum of confidence. And everyone needs to have their own spectrum of confidence. And so in the workshop, we lead you to building this out for yourself, a 1 through 7. By the way, we do this with hedge funds too. John and Evan have been involved in that. And I have certain words here, panic, confident, overconfident, but your words might be different for 1 to 7. And it's really important because the research shows that there's something called emotion differentiation and emotion granularity, and the people who have more of it make more money. So building out this 1 to 7 is about you creating some emotion granularity and emotion differentiation. Differentiation is the difference between fear, frustration, disappointment, big broad categories. And emotion granularity is like this, the 1 to 7. Like, is it panic? Is it terrified? You know, we had Bill and I did a workshop with one hedge fund right before the pandemic started, and their overconfident was bulletproof. And so the ability to know the words and then to use the words has shown to help you understand like the feeling you're predicting and then make a decision that's more about the here and now as opposed to some fear in the future. And then we figure out for you, like what feeds into that, you know, missing out, everybody has some missing out, future regret, I'm going to feel bad in the future. Am I worried about being wrong, looking stupid? You know, at what point do I start to worry about disaster and survival? Everyone has their own personal version of this mental matrix. And what I wanted for my, you know, people who came to Sun Valley this summer, and what I want for the people who sign up for these 12 weeks is to end with a personal version of this that you feel comfortable with, that you can use. And what does it do? It helps you really notice that difference between intuition and impulse, being able to figure out where you are at any given point in your own matrix. So here's the advertisement part. You know, these are the details. You've all seen that. If you've seen the website, 12 weeks of instruction, small group, specific exercises, there's a coupon that's good through Friday. And then, you know, we normally in our coaching at Rethink ask people to sign up for a year, but we'll make available some shorter, you know, 6-week, 3-month segments for people who take the workshop to just make, if you just want to make sure that you've absorbed it and figured out how to use it. So with that, I think I'll stop sharing my screen, and then I can probably figure out how to unmute everyone. Or I can try. Or if you want to speak, raise your hand, I guess, and I have to say okay. And Bill, if you're here, maybe you can figure out how to unmute everyone. Oh, here's more.
I think you could unmute yourself, Denise. I just did.
Okay. Samir asking in the chat, and you can also put a question in the chat. Do you think it's better to not trade than trade without having this level of deep feeling expertise? Well, do I think so? Yeah, I personally think so. But obviously people are successful traders without having this. I mean, first of all, you know, very few people in the world even know this, but like take Evan and John, and I'm gonna, you know, Evan and John both called me to coach them when they were still trading full-time. They were both very successful, but what? They wanted to be more successful, or they saw a certain sort of, sorry, Bill's texting me about that. about the mute and unmute. They saw something they want to get better at. Like Evan and John, why don't you guys talk about that for a minute?
Okay.
Ahead, John.
So for me, I think of trading as stacking edges. So every opportunity I got to stack an advantage, whether it was a physical workout, whether it was learning more about option theory, whether it was diet, whether it was working with Denise on my mental game, for me, every single one of those stacked on top of each other. And the more I could kind of put together, the more my edge grew in my mind and the better I traded. So I worked with Denise for 5 or 6 years before I started coaching with the Rethink Group. And, you know, I started to understand myself better, and really she helped me understand what my intuitive ability was. And she really helped me understand where that edge came in. And that was a huge advantage for me.
I was a long short equity hedge fund trader for over like 28 years, two hedge funds actually. And I sold my partnership in 2017, you know, mid 17 to work full time with the Rethink Group. And I had many coaches. I don't know if you've read books by Ari Kiev. I was one of his original guys, and it was always be competent, do more work, plan it, get bigger, be competent. No emotions, no mention of emotions, never. So 2015, I caught myself in a little bit of pickle, and somebody recommended Denise Schull and said that she has got such a different way of doing things. I'm like, I'll give it a shot. And boom, we never discussed feelings. You know, on my board, my whiteboard now says, how am I feeling? And I think what Denise said was dead on, like doing and feeling instead of feeling the feeling. If I knew that decades ago, I think I would have retired early. But it's very true. When you're able to put words to your feelings, it changes the game. And now nobody did it ever. And I've dealt with many, many coaches, and nobody did. It's such a different, it's a different idea. I think a lot of people come to these workshops because they've never heard of something like this, how you could put these things together. I think that's what makes it so unique and so powerful. I'm a living example of that.
Yeah, thank you. We're glad you are. We're glad you're here as one of our coaches. John, I see in the chat, since your workshop has components of the mind game, can we get a link to that resource? Meaning the brain game, that you can link to the brain game both on our website. I think it's under services, the rethinkgroup.net. And so, the intuition brain game is under there. I mean, if you sign up for this workshop, will we include the $8.99 a month into intuition brain game? Sure. I'm not worried about that. Anthony, thank you. So, I'm afraid to like try to go to Google and type anything, because I'm afraid like I'll mess up the room. So that's partially why I didn't do that, just so you know.
That's okay. I have a question for you, Denise.
Yeah.
About this workshop. So I used your kind of self-study workshop that you did, about 7 or 8 years ago. How is this different? Is this ahead of where we were back then? Could you clarify that, please?
Yeah, so you're probably talking about access your psychological capital.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
Yes.
The brain science has come a little bit further in this whole predictive future emotion, and that you're always doing that and figuring out exactly how that works in your trading. And then figuring out, you know, I've come up with a few more strategies and tactics than we're in. Access. So, I mean, it's an evolution of that, truthfully. I mean, some of it's going to be very similar. Like that mental matrix that we just did, you know, I said a personal version, that's figuring out like what the fractal really is. And for those of you who don't know, the fractal is, you know, how we expect to get what we got, basically. Now, in expecting, like, you know, Freud is the one who first noticed we expect to get what we got. called the repetition compulsion. My master's research is about how could that happen on a brain level. But for the most part, it was like, know that you do that and stop doing it. And like that only works a little. But once you add the aspect of you actually are expecting this future feeling, and that future feeling is about mostly about surviving and safety, you know, hopefully it's about thriving, but you have to like evolve and grow for those future feelings to be about thriving. Yeah. That's like this lever into that psychological reality that we didn't have before. So I take a lot of similar material. I literally went through the slide sets for every workshop I ever gave, Access Your Psychological Capital. And there were a whole series of others that we did. I went through all the slides, pulled out the best and put it in order, and also tried to be like amazingly practical about it. So it won't be all new. It'll just be like Access Your Psychological Capital 3.0.
Okay, so I should be able to go deeper into the issues that I've been dealing with, going through your workshop several times over the last several years. So this is kind of the next step into intuition, into creating, you said, this matrix is going to help me to understand how to make the decisions I want to make to go from surviving to thriving. When you said those words, go from survival mentality to thriving mentality, do you believe that going through this workshop will help me to get to that next level?
I'm going to be honest. I think the way it works is you get more ability to interrupt the survival instincts, to dilute them. And that gives you more capacity to access the thriving instincts.
I understand what you're saying.
So it's slightly different than what you said.
Yes.
But it's kind of, on a mental point, it's sort of like, you know, if you avoid the 25% of your worst trade, you have more opportunities to make the money from your good trades, right? It's kind of like that on a mental basis. Okay. You have more capacity to interrupt the impulses that come out of the survival predictions or survival threats, really. And part of that's through understanding what they really truly are. Like, I will tell you, and I'm not just saying this, it's true. And if there's anybody here that was there this summer, I said things in Sun Valley face-to-face with people that I'd never said before, because there are some things about all of this that are really like psychologically deep, you know, and can be sort of overwhelming and threatening, and I can't just tweet it or, you know, but we will do that here. And then to support you, you'll have the discussion groups and access to me for questions, you know. So I don't want to say like, you know, it's, I think if anybody who knows me knows, you know, I'm not a big marketing person. So I don't want to overstate it, but I also don't want to understate it.
Yeah. I mean, I'm just wondering, you know, just I'm looking to get to that next level. And I like the work that I've read your book, you know, and I've done the workshop, the, you know, self-study workshop a few times. It's been very beneficial. I just wanted to see what potentially I can get out of doing this. Is this for someone who's never really interacted with you or done your work before? Or can this, some of the things you're saying I like the fact that you said you told people things in Sun Valley face to face that you would never tell them in a tweet or even in a workshop like this.
But we will do that. I mean, it's part of the reason for having the 12 weeks, you know, like we have enough time to really cover this. We have enough time to really go in detail. I see that actually somebody, Josh, I'm going to figure out how to.
Hey, Denise, can I just jump in real quick before Josh?
Yeah.
I did the original Access as well. And it was fantastic, but the thinking has become much more streamlined and really applying it to action is where I think Denise has developed it. And again, like she said, the science has changed too. So it's certainly, Access was fantastic. It's very deep, but this And the interaction in small groups will be very helpful to get your personal experience to come out and become more clear.
Josh, I see you have your hand up. Can you speak?
I can speak. Can you hear me?
I can. Josh was in Sun Valley, so he can tell you.
I wanted to say, as I'm listening to you here, that the biggest thing I got out of the Sun Valley workshop is learning to put words to those emotions, but also the things that you brought out in me made me address a lot of emotions that I didn't want to address and that are really dangerous and damaging to your trading. And if anyone here thinks they don't have those emotions, that's a pretty good sign that you do have them, in my opinion. And for me, I mean, it was a world of difference once I came away and was able to have those tools to work with it.
Thank you. There's a, you know, there's a couple of aspects that are just difficult.
Josh and Denise. So Josh, because you went through the workshop, did you find this also gave you tools to address other areas of your life and kind of make them better?
Absolutely. I actually believe that trading is a tool to, if you look at it this way, to improve your life. A lot of the problems I have in trading are life problems. They're the way I handle everything. I mean, there's this saying, the way you do one thing is the way you do everything. And however you're dealing with your emotions or hiding them or not addressing them or becoming aware of them, you're most likely doing that in your life in general. And I've definitely found that to be the truth. And it definitely kind of pulled the curtains back for me a little bit on some of that.
What actually happened is when I got done with Sun Valley, which was the first like public workshop I'd done in since 2007, I thought, you know what, I'm going to turn this into a new Access Your Psychological Chap, new you know what I mean, that course that we used to have. And I still do actually want to do that, eventually make a new self-directed course. But as I was thinking about it, I thought, we've got all this content together. We've got the feedback from the Sun Valley people. Why don't we just try 12 weeks online instead of 12 hours, you know, live in a hotel conference room, because we could reach a lot more people. So that's literally how this happened. So I thought, well, why should I wait? Tom Winterstein, can you compare and contrast the pros and cons of participating in the workshop versus working with one of your coaches individually? The first thing that comes to mind, you work with a coach. We work with, like, we meet you where you are and ask questions to guide you to the next step. We don't so much in one-on-one coaching educate. So we follow where you are and what you need on any one day, but you don't get the kind of big picture, organized viewpoint of what's really happening with you, because that, you know, you're not paying us to teach you per se. I mean, it isn't to say we don't teach a little here and there, surely, but it's not this kind of overarching understanding of what the brain's doing vis-a-vis the market. And to illustrate that, and John and Evan can verify this, whenever any new hedge fund or long only fund or anyone calls us and says, we want to bring the Rethink group in, you know, we want some coaches, we want, John and Evan know the first thing I say, Bill, if he's here, knows the first thing I say, well, how we should start is we should do a workshop. Because if we do a workshop, it's a level set for everyone on the basics of, you know, your brain versus risk, your brain versus the market. And if you don't have that, in a way, the one-on-one work could be perceived as inefficient. Now, it's also true, in a hedge fund, I want them all to have heard all these things about emotion so that they're ready to start one-on-one coaching. So it's basically that. You know, we guide you based on where you are in coaching, and we give you the big picture, and, you know, you kind of see what you can do on your own, knowing like the right view of how the brain's really working vis-a-vis the market and how emotions are really working and how intuition, et cetera. What else?
No, thank you, Denise. You gave me the answers that I need to evaluate doing this, and I think it's definitely worth exploring. So thank you, and thank you to Josh as well for sharing his experience with me. It's helpful. Yeah, I like it. I like what you're doing.
Good. I see a question from, I'm going to pronounce it, Andreas. John, Josh, how did the Rethink course impact your equity curve? I'm going to throw that to Evan too.
Well, I've definitely had positive returns when it comes to my equity curve. Probably a lot more so than anything else I've ever done. I was on a little bit of a upward curve anyway, and it just accelerated me from there. So yeah, it was paid me back tenfold already.
I should charge commission.
I've been doing this since 2008, so it's been really great for me.
I think go ahead, Dave.
No, go on, Evan.
I think my equity curve was very helpful. But going to what Josh said and coaching, it helped out a lot of other things, you know, intuition, impulsivity, how we behave. You know, for all my clients, you know, we always have goals that at the end of the day, there's progress. But it's amazing how a lot of things are connected. And I think what Josh said, sometimes, you know, the byproducts are just amazing. Because like, I got to tell you this, this is incredible what happened to me yesterday. And it's very rewarding to hear that, but that's what happens. You know, because a lot of people say that trading is one of the biggest self-development games in the world. And we're not accountability coaches at all. But like, Dee, we give you the tools, you know, the science, the experience to make obviously better decisions, but there is a greater impact that goes on.
Yeah, I mean, we do hear that all the time.
We hear that, you know, a lot, yeah.
Helped with my family life, helped with my health.
Yeah.
Rodrigo, I went through your workshops. I did a lot of digging to uncover my fractals. I found that I need some guidance. What is your suggestion? Well, one of the things we talk about in this workshop that I haven't talked about so much is defense mechanisms and the role of anger and unconscious rage and even... even like a Freudian Oedipal sort of thing, and how people competing with their fathers or their mothers plays into their surviving and thriving. And so that's the piece I haven't talked about so much in the future, because it's just, or in the past, I mean, because it's so hard for, you know, it's so personal for people. But I was also struck by the way the group in Sun Valley reacted to those things and how helpful they thought it would be. And how they felt that it was. So, you know, obviously I can't guarantee, but if you've read my book, if you've taken access, and now you take this workshop, do I think that you'll come out of it with a more robust understanding of yourself? I do. And if I didn't, I don't even think I would offer it. Sometimes the really specific, you know, nitty gritty, ugly details of anyone's given past, you know, it's helpful to do one-on-one work. You know, will you be in a small group that you feel comfortable talking about it? We hope. Will Evan, John, and Bill lead the small group to help you talk about that in a way that might be similar to one-on-one coaching? I mean, that's the objective. You know, obviously we can't control people's personalities and, you know, if someone's aggressive or talks too much, but, you know, we're pretty good at knowing how to work with a group. So I think this should lead to the next level of understanding oneself. Melanie, a difference working with men versus women. Oh, wait, I have to scroll back up. Let me scroll. I can't. It's the men versus women question. You know, I don't get to work with that many women. I have one female professional portfolio manager. So the truth is, I never feel I can answer this women versus men so much. I mean, theoretically, women should be, you know, they're not socialized as much to ignore their emotions, but you know, in a year's way past. Like I had two female clients, but they were both military brats. So you can imagine, you know, they weren't socialized to have their emotions. So it's really personal. That's part of it. And part of it is I don't have enough experience. Anyone else? What else can I tell you? What else can we tell you? I appreciate you all being here. This will be available by recording also once we figure out how to get it up there. Greg, we're going to hold them different times. It depends on how many people total sign up. But, you know, I have a max of 48. I don't think we're going to get 48. But if we get 48, we're going to do six groups of eight. And so there'll be different times. But there'll be different times regardless. Now, we'd like people to get in one small group and stick with it. You know, if it ends up that doesn't work. All of it's on the page, the rethinkgroup.net Market Mind Games Live. The fees, I did put a coupon up, Halloween. The basic workshop is going to be this time Wednesdays after the close, 2:30 my time, 4:30. So every week we'll have an instructional hour that'll be recorded. And then every week you'll have a group discussion hour. Every week you'll also be given homework to do, which you won't obviously have to turn in or anything, but that homework will build on itself. Anything else? I appreciate the interest. Send us, you know, if you have more questions, send them to think@therethinkgroup.net. And we'll try to answer them. And hopefully this in and of itself was a little bit helpful. I mean, I didn't mean this to be like just completely a sales webinar for the workshop. I was trying to give you some of the basic ideas that we've added to, you know, and the trick to the brain game, which is not thinking. All right, I think we'll sign off. I appreciate everyone's time. Take care. You're welcome. I appreciate all that.